Good evening, aspirants. Welcome to the Hindi News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 12th May 2019. The list of articles which have been chosen for today's analysis, along with the page numbers of Chennai, Bengaluru, Delhi, and Thiruvananthapuram editions, are provided here. The link for the handwritten notes in the PDF format and the timestamping for the displayed articles has been provided in the description box below. And for the benefit of smartphone users, the timestamping has also been provided in the comment section. With this, let us move on to the first article for the day. This article has appeared on page 10 of Chennai, Delhi and Thiruvananthapuram editions and on page 12 of Bengaluru edition. The discussion based on this article will be relevant in prelims preparation under the area current events of national and international importance, and it will be relevant in main syllabus under GS paper 2 in the areas India and its neighborhood relations, then in bilateral, regional and global groupings and agreements involving India and or in affecting India's interests, and then in effect of policies and politics of developed and developing countries on India's interests. Stepping into the main discussion, the news article discusses about the recent development in the India-Australia relationship. India and Australia are moving towards a classified communications environment. India moving to this classified communications environment would enable India to be a part of combined task force operations relating to counter-terrorism, anti-piracy and maritime security. It will be of great significance as it will enable India to talk to and be a part of like-minded countries that have a communication system that is operating at the classified level under this combined task force operations. At present juncture, India and Australia are having communication in an unclassified environment. In this environment, an age-old tradition of ships meeting on the high seas is carried out. Here we need to note that Australian Navy is not a part of COMCASA agreement, but India signed this agreement with USA last year. The officials noted that the COMCASA was a major step for interaction between navies of two countries that are restricted to the classified environment. For example, conversations on counterterrorism. Now in this context, let us see in detail about the COMCASA agreement with an examination point of view. In September 2018, India and the US signed the foundational or enabling agreement COMCASA on the sidelines of inaugural of 2+2 dialogue. COMCASA stands for Communications Compatibility and Security Agreement. It is one of the four foundational agreements that the US signs with allies and close partners. COMCASA facilitates the interoperability between militaries and sale of high-end technology. It is a bilateral pact for secure military communications. COMCASA is an India-specific version of the Communication and Information on Security Memorandum of Agreement, in short, CISMOA or CISMOA. The COMCASA agreement is valid for a period of 10 years. And it allows India to procure and transfer specialized equipments for encrypted communications. It is meant to facilitate the use of high-end secured communication equipment to be installed on military platforms and to receive modern, secure and net-enabled weapon system such as precision armament, air-to-air missiles, space systems and navigation systems that are critical components in platforms like fighter aircraft and unmanned aerial systems. Currently, India relies on commercially available communication systems for US sourced platforms like C-130Js and the P-8I maritime surveillance aircraft. But COMCASA is necessary for the Sea Guardian drones that India is keen on acquiring from the US, since these operate on a secure data and communication system link. The joint statement issued by India and US after the 2+2 dialogue said that COMCASA would facilitate India to access advanced defense systems and enable India to optimally utilize its existing US origin platforms. As we saw, COMCASA will enable greater communications interoperability between the militaries of India and US. Here, more importantly, we have to note that data acquired through such systems cannot be disclosed or transferred to any person or entity without India's consent. Additionally, some specific provisions have been incorporated in the agreement text to safeguard India's security and national interests. So, both countries will implement this agreement in a manner that is consistent with the national security interests of each other. Despite all the perceptions of how the COMCASA puts India within the Privy Council of the USA and its perceived benefits, there are some valid and grave concerns that must be addressed. Let us see what these concerns are, which worries the experts, and this will also help you in your mains answer writing. First concern is that COMCASA would compromise encrypted Indian communications by enabling the US military to listen into Indian systems. And the next concern is it could provide incompatible India's Russian origin military platforms with high-end assets acquired from the US. Some believe that the US insistence on COMCASA stems from US's growing discomfort with the India-Russia defense relationship. The experts point out that New Delhi's continuing dependence on Russian weaponry has even led cautious US officials to call for a firewall between India's cooperation with Russia and its cooperation with the US. Next concern is that US military may misuse the communication system for spying on India. Another major concern is regarding COMCASA putting India's military bases under US inspection. The details of COMCASA between India and the US is not yet available in the public domain. But based on the agreement signed between South Korea and the USA, it gives us an idea about the extent of inspection which will be imposed by America. Moreover, under the CISMOA, the maintenance and the repair of the equipment is only accessible to US personnel, and therefore, countries have to open their defense facilities to the USA, which is the major concern here. Another issue of equally grave concern stems from the objective of USA to fix the US-India balance of trade in favor of USA. This has resulted in a full-blown trade war with China. For this, the US administration has eyed the defense sector of India, and the COMCASA is the tool through which they intend to do it. As we know, India is the second largest importer of defense products, and like any other country, USA wants to grab the biggest chunk of pie. And for this, they have to cross the biggest hurdle, which is securing its military technology. So US just cannot sell its most capable products without COMCASA, because it needs to secure its military technology so that it is not transferred to any third country. Hence, it is understood that the interoperability is just another tool used by the US to secure its defense technology. From the US perspective, COMCASA not only meant to ensure the protection of US military interests, but also to create a string of dependency for the client state. If we look at the cases of many client states of US like Pakistan, which have a history of importing high technology and cutting-edge weapons from the American supply chain, Pakistan had to considerably compromise on an array of sovereign choices, and invariably these nations get forced into accepting the American diktat in their foreign policies as well as defense policies. In other words, the client loses its sovereign authority to wield independent power over its own territory. For example, one can remember the intrusion of US Special Forces into Pakistani territory during Operation Neptune Spear in May 2011 and the series of targeted drone strikes against Al-Qaeda and Taliban hideouts are instructive cases of violation of Pakistan's sovereign airspace. With this, we come to the end of this discussion. The displayed practice questions will be discussed in the last session. Moving on to the next article discussion, which is about electric mobility in India. This article has appeared on page 14 in Chennai, Delhi and Thiruvananthapuram editions and on page 16 of Bengaluru edition. The information under this discussion will be relevant in the prelim syllabus under the area Current Events of National Importance in Economic and Social Development and in General Issues on Environmental Ecology and Climate Change also. And in the main syllabus under GS Paper 2 in the areas Government Policies and Interventions for Development in Various Sectors and Issues Arising Out of Their Design and Implementation. And the discussion can also be linked to Environmental Pollution and Degradation in General Studies Paper 3. The article talks about the Ola Electric Mobility Private Limited, which has recently received a huge investment to scale up electric vehicle deployment in India. In this context, the author discusses some frequently asked questions with respect to electric vehicles and India's policy on electric vehicles. Before getting into the article, let us first have a look at the recently notified Phase 2 of FAME India scheme to understand the article completely. The phase 2 of the scheme was notified on 8th March 2019 by the Ministry of Heavy Industries and Public Enterprises. FAME stands for Faster Adoption and Manufacturing of Electric Vehicles in India. The first phase commenced on 1st April 2015 and was initially approved for 2 years only. This was later extended till 31st March of 2019. Phase 1 was a sort of pilot project just to see the reaction of people to the electric and hybrid vehicles, and therefore it was not implemented for all categories of vehicles in the entire country. It was made applicable only for two-wheelers and three-wheelers under phase 1 of the scheme in the entire country. For other categories of vehicles, the scheme was implemented in all state capitals and other urban agglomerations or cities with more than 10 lakh populations based on 2011 census, and also in major metro agglomerations and cities under smart cities initiatives, and also in cities of the northeastern states of India. Now let us see about the recently notified phase 2 of FAME India scheme. In phase 2, the scheme will be implemented over a period of 3 years, from 1st April 2019 to 31st March 2022. The objective of this scheme is to promote faster adoption of electric mobility, to increase the coverage of electric vehicles and development of manufacturing ecosystem for electric vehicles in our country. Note that the Department of Heavy Industry that comes under Ministry of Heavy Industries and Public Enterprises is responsible for the overall implementation of the scheme. And the department is also the nodal agency or department for the planning, implementation and review of the scheme. There is also one committee under the chairmanship of the Secretary of the Department of Heavy Industry, which is called as Project Implementation and Sanctioning Committee. It includes members from other ministries also, and hence it is called as Interministerial Empowered Committee. This committee will be having the role of monitoring, sanctioning and implementation of the scheme. This scheme will be implemented based on demand incentives, establishment of network of charging stations and administration of the scheme using publicity, information, education and communication. Demand incentives are incentives that help to generate demand of electric vehicles by reducing the cost of purchase price of electric vehicles, and these incentives are based on battery capacity that are used in the vehicles. The scheme proposes support for setting up of adequate public charging infrastructure to instill confidence among the electric vehicle users. The scheme has also stated the details of maximum number of vehicles to be supported in the next 3 years. Support under the scheme will be extended to 10 lakh two-wheeler electric vehicles, 5 lakhs three-wheelers including electric rickshaws, and 35,000 four-wheelers that are not strong hybrid vehicles, and 20,000 four-wheelers that are strong hybrid vehicles, and around 7,090 electric buses also, incorrectly mentioned in the newspaper as 7,000. Here, note that 64% support has been extended to two-wheelers and 32% to three-wheelers. This means a total of around 96% of proposed government support is available for these vehicles. These vehicles are referred by the author as smaller vehicles. With this background, let us step into the article discussion. India has targeted to achieve 30% of electric vehicles by 2030 in the overall composition of the vehicles, and in the next 5 years, the government has aimed to achieve 15%. The government of India targets smaller vehicles due to a unique mobility pattern seen in India, which other countries do not share. If you see the total vehicles based on the last 6 years of sales data, the vehicles on Indian roads are estimated to consist of 79% of two-wheelers, 4% three-wheelers, 12% economic four-wheelers, and 2% premium four-wheelers, and 3% of buses and large goods vehicles. Premium four-wheelers are those vehicles that cost more than 10 lakhs, and economic four-wheelers are those four-wheelers that cost less than 10 lakhs. This is the reason why the government has extended maximum support to the two-wheelers in FAME India scheme in phase 2. Unlike China and USA, India has a different approach of providing non-fiscal incentives to the vehicle manufacturers. Fiscal incentives refer to exemption from payment of local taxes, fees and charges, or providing subsidies to the manufacturers. On the other hand, non-fiscal incentives refer to the services and assistance provided to the manufacturers by the government. For electric vehicle manufacturers, India offers credits based on carbon dioxide emissions per kilometer and also based on vehicle efficiency. Those manufacturers who exceed the emission targets will have to purchase credits, whereas those manufacturers who meet the emission targets will be rewarded. Thus, this incentive will have a significant impact, as this approach will make electric vehicles with low emissions cheaper and the polluting vehicles expensive. The author also points to the demand incentives and the government's support for setting up the public charging stations in the country through FAME India Phase 2 scheme, which we have just discussed. Coming to whether electric vehicles adoption will reduce carbon emission, the author states that it will reduce the exhaust pipe carbon emission of the vehicles and particulate matter in particular. But the author states that despite large-scale adoption of electric vehicles that may happen in future, the net reduction in carbon emission will not be much, as India generates electricity to the tune of about 55% from coal. To the question about is there enough cobalt to meet the demand for batteries, the author states that lithium-ion batteries are the most widely used battery for electric vehicles, particularly cars. Cobalt, which is a byproduct of mining nickel and copper, is used as a cathode or positive electrode in these batteries. It is cobalt that prevents overheating of the battery and allows for charging and discharging. Around 60% of the world's supply of cobalt comes from the Democratic Republic of Congo, or in short DR Congo, which is a country in the African continent. The mining of cobalt in DR Congo has been linked to human rights abuse, including child labor. Also, the author notes that as battery technology evolves, the amount of cobalt available for use may either reduce or even stop. With this, we come to the end of this discussion. The displayed prelims question will be discussed in the last session. Moving on to the next article, which is about the change in lifestyle of Maldhari tribes. This article has appeared in page 14 of today's magazine supplementary of the newspaper, and this magazine is common for all the four editions. This discussion based on this news article will be helpful in your prelims preparation under the area social geography. Let us know about Maldhari tribes in brief from prelims point of view. Maldhari tribes are basically a pastoral community. Pastoral means animal herders. They generally keep moving to different places in search of food for the animals. Maldhari tribes largely live in bunny grasslands in the run of Kutch, which is in the state of Gujarat. These tribes also live in the Gir region and have a close harmony with the lions. Maldhari tribes are known for rearing unique breeds of livestock, namely Kankrej cows, bunny buffalo, which yields a fat rich milk, and Karai camels also. Let us know about bunny grasslands in brief now. It is an arid grassland ecosystem. These grasslands are too saline to perform agriculture, but some fertile grasses grow here, which becomes food for the livestock. Few animals are also found in these bunny grasslands, like Nilgai, which is a blue buck, then Chinkara, which is also known as Indian gazelle, then foxes, spring-tailed lizards, and also desert cats. Now let us see the lifestyle changes that have affected the Maldhari community. A rough timeline of Maldhari community's lifestyle before independence and their present lifestyle is compared here for your easy understanding. In British India, Maldharis used to wander long distances from Gujarat to the present Sindh province in Pakistan, but their movements have been restricted after the partition of India and Pakistan. At present, Maldhari community largely roams in the Kutch and Gir area of Gujarat. This long distance wandering or migration happened exclusively to rear their livestock, but now the grasslands have largely been replaced with Prosopis juliflora. Also, the land use patterns have largely changed in this region. Both of these factors have led to the production in their migration. Maldaris are known for their nomadic way of life, but now the government is trying to settle them in one place permanently. This is largely affecting their lifestyle as well. And also during dry seasons, Maldaris would go short of food and fodder for their livestock. So they would end up selling their livestock. But at present, fodder is being sourced from faraway places. They are supplied by trains and trucks, such that there is enough food source available for the livestock throughout the year. Maldaris are known to handle the water scarcity with their traditional method of tapping into groundwater. Veerdas are shallow wells dug in low depressions called jheels. Jheels are nothing but tanks. Here, the inhabitants collect enough rainwater in order to ensure the availability of fresh water throughout the year. The topography of Banni is very flat. It has only few depressions on the ground. By studying the flow of water during monsoon rainfall, the Maldaris identified these depressions. This complex rainwater harvesting technique depends on the smooth functioning of the delicate ecosystem of the area. Significant grass cover is necessary to allow free infiltration of fresh water. The supply of the drinking water through pipeline from the nearby city of Bhuj has led to the reduced dependence of Maldaris on the water. Thus, the lifestyle of Maldaris is largely becoming sedentary now. Also, the proliferation of Prosopis juliflora has thwarted or blocked the growth of the grass, and it has brought salt up to the soil surface. And then indigenous plant species of the Banni have registered an alarming decline, and Veerdas, the shallow wells in some areas, are fast becoming saline. The news is that continuous drought has now become a huge source of worry. In this context, let us see about the effect of Prosopis juliflora in Maldaris economy. Prosopis juliflora was introduced in 1960s to prevent desertification. Tree has spread so rapidly that it has eaten into almost 60% of the grassland. To the Maldaris, this has meant a huge loss of pastures, which are a food source to their livestock. But it has also meant unexpected income for Maldaris. Prosopis charcoal has a sizable market demand. This has helped Maldaris substitute grass with market-bought fodder during dry seasons. Now, this has created a paradox that even though pasture has reduced, livestock holdings per individuals have grown, primarily of the Banni buffalo. This buffalo is known for its ability to produce high-fat milk despite scarcity. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of this article. The displayed prelims question will be discussed in the last session. Moving on to the next article for the day, which is about the disqualification of MLAs. This news article has appeared on page 14 of Chennai, Delhi and Thiruvananthapuram edition and on page 16 of Bengaluru edition. The discussion and topics which will be covered based on this article is relevant in the prelims preparation under Indian Polity, and in the mains preparation, it is relevant in GS Paper 2 under Parliament and State, Structure, Organization and Functioning of Executive and Judiciary, and also in the Representation of People's Act. The article deals with the Tamil Nadu politics and its possible outcomes, which is not relevant from examination point of view. But it also discusses about anti-defection law and why does it matter. This part is important for our examination. The background for this article is the Supreme Court order staying the proceedings initiated by Tamil Nadu Assembly Speaker for the disqualification of three MLAs of the ruling party. Now let us see what the issue is. It all began when the chief government whip complained that the MLAs of a party one had associated themselves with political party two. So in this context, we should know who a whip is. A whip is an official of a political party whose main task is to ensure party discipline in a legislature. This simply means that the members of the party should attend and vote as the party leadership desires, and thus maintain discipline and behavior in the floor of the house. Now, if a member of a party 1 is providing his support to party 2 in the form of his vote or otherwise, then it is called as defection. In such cases, the anti-defection law will be applied. The anti-defection law is mentioned in the 10th schedule of the constitution, and it prevents defection of a member of a party to another political party. Now let's discuss the grounds of disqualification of the member under the Anti-Defection Law, which is also a part of Representation of People's Act of 1951 under Section 7 and 8. The first ground is that if an elected member is voluntarily giving up his membership of a political party. And the second ground is if he votes or does not vote by acting contrary to a direction issued by his political party. Similarly, there are two exceptions for this disqualification also. First one is if a person is elected as a speaker or chairman, then he should resign from his party and rejoin back once his tenure as speaker or chairman is over. Here, disqualification will not be applicable. Second exception is when 1/3 of the party members votes for a merger, then the party will be merged into another party. Here also, disqualification will not apply. Now, coming back to the article, it says that the government whip complained that the MLAs were associated with party 2, and so disqualification proceedings were initiated as per anti-defection law. And then the three MLAs approached court against this and obtained a stay order. Meanwhile, the opposition party has issued a no confidence motion against the speaker, because while the no confidence motion is pending, the speaker cannot act upon the disqualification of members, which is what the article points to. Now, in this context, let us discuss what is the no confidence motion. A no confidence motion is a vote that states that the government or member is no longer fit to hold the position. A no confidence motion can be moved by any member of the house, but only in Lok Sabha. A no confidence motion cannot be moved in Rajya Sabha, keep in mind. Here note that with reference to the state legislature, the no confidence motion can be moved only in state legislative assembly and not in state legislative council. A no confidence motion will affect the government because a government can function only when it has majority support in the Lok Sabha. The party can remain in power when it shows its strength through a floor test. If any member of the house feels that the government in power does not have a majority, they can move a no confidence motion. If the motion is accepted, then the party in power has to prove its majority in the house. Here, the member who moves for the no confidence motion need not give any reason. Now, why does this no confidence motion matter to the Tamil Nadu scenario? Suppose the court had not stayed the disqualification proceedings, then the three MLAs will be disqualified and the house's strength will be further down. In that case, the ruling party will need only two more members to present its strength, which is why no confidence motion has mattered in the Tamil Nadu scenario. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of this article. The displayed prelims question will be discussed in the last session. Moving on to the last article for the day, which is about the UN Accord to curb export of plastic waste. This news article appears in page 20 of Chennai and Delhi editions and on page 22 on Bengaluru and Thiruvananthapuram editions. The contents of this discussion will be relevant in your prelims preparation under current events of international importance and also under general issues on environmental ecology. Stepping into the main discussion, the news article talks about the new UN accord to regulate the export of plastic waste. And this accord has been agreed by 180 governments across the world. Around 1,400 representatives met in Geneva and have reached the agreement after 12 days of discussion. This Geneva meeting has amended the 1989 Basel Convention on the Control of Hazardous Wastes. This amendment will include plastic waste in a legally binding framework. The meeting also agreed to eliminate two toxic chemical groups, namely Dicofol and perfluorooctanoic acid. The perfluorooctanoic acid is used in a wide variety of industrial and domestic applications. That includes your non-stick cookware, food processing equipments, and also in carpets, papers, and paints. This news article discussion is based around 1989 Basel Conventions. So, let us know about the background and objectives of 1989 Basel Convention in brief. The full name of the convention is Basel Convention on the Control of Transboundary Movements of Hazardous Wastes and Their Disposal. This convention was adopted in the year 1989 and it came into force in the year 1992. This convention is a legally binding framework. Here, legally binding framework establishes broader commitments for its parties. Who are the member nations? and it leaves the setting of specific targets to the individual member parties only. It can be in the form of subsequent more detailed agreements or in the form of a national legislation also. Here, the detailed agreements are usually called as protocols. Now, you need to know the background of why this 1989 Basel Convention came into existence. The environmental awareness was at its peak in the industrialized world in the 1970s and 1980s. It was at this time that environmental regulations became very stricter in these industrialized nations. Stricter regulations led to an escalation of disposal costs of these wastes. Also, there was an increasing public resistance to the disposal of hazardous waste near their residential areas. This was famously called as "not in my backyard" syndrome. Because of this, some waste disposal operators started searching for cheap disposal options for hazardous wastes. They ended up transporting the waste to Eastern Europe and also to the other countries of developing world in Asia and Africa. The environmental awareness was very less developed, and regulations and enforcement mechanisms were lacking in these countries. It was against this background that the Basel Convention was negotiated in the late 1980s. The convention entered into force in 1992. The main objective of the Basel Convention is to protect human health and the environment against the adverse effects of hazardous wastes. Its scope of application covers a wide range of wastes defined as hazardous wastes, as well as other wastes which are classified into two, namely household waste and incinerator ash. This is classified based on their origin and or composition and their characteristics also. Next, let us know in brief about IPEN. IPEN is a global network of public interest NGOs. They work with a common commitment to achieve a toxic-free future. IPEN has commented that the amendment to 1989 Basel Convention will empower the developing countries to refuse dumping plastic waste by others. Here, others means the developed nations. Since we have studied about Basel Conventions now, try to know about BRS Conventions as well. BRS Convention is a collective term used for three different conventions. The three conventions are B for Basel Convention, R for Rotterdam Convention, and S for Stockholm Convention. All these three deal with international environmental law. As we saw, Basel Convention deals with control of transboundary movements of hazardous wastes and their disposal. India ratified the Basel Convention in the year 1992. Next, the Rotterdam Convention deals with prior informed consent procedure for certain hazardous chemical products and pesticides in international trade. India got accession to this convention in the year 2005. And finally, Stockholm Convention deals with persistent organic pollutants. We saw that India got accession to Rotterdam Convention in the year 2005. There is a small difference between ratification and accession. Here, accession is similar to ratification, but it is not preceded by an act of signature. With this, we come to the end of the analysis session. The practice prelims question will be discussed in the next session. Moving on to the last session for the day, which is the practice questions discussion session. The first question is, which one of the following best describes the term COMCASA agreement sometimes seen in news? First option, it enables the sharing of a range of geospatial products, including access to mapping and hydrophobic data. Option B, it enables deployed forces to share logistics support to meet unforeseen requirements that might arise in the field or unanticipated mission requirements. Option C, it facilitates the interoperability between militaries and sale of high-end technology. Option D, it prevents the spread of nuclear weapons and weapons technology to promote cooperation in the peaceful uses of nuclear energy. Here, if you see, the first option is Basic Exchange and Cooperation Agreement for Geospatial Cooperation. That is in short, BECA Agreement of USA. So it is not COMCASA Agreement. The second option is the Logistics Exchange Memorandum of Agreement. That is LEMOA Agreement. And the last option is the Treaty on the Non-Proliferation of Nuclear Weapons. That is the NPT Treaty. So that is also the wrong option. So, the correct answer to this question is option C. It facilitates the interoperability between militaries and sale of high-end technology. Next question is, Consider the following statements with reference to the FAME India scheme phase 2. First statement, the scheme aims to promote faster adoption of electric vehicles and development of manufacturing ecosystem for electric vehicles. Second statement, the maximum number of vehicles to be supported in this phase are the two-wheelers. Third statement, Ministry of New and Renewable Energy is the nodal ministry responsible for the planning, implementation and review of the scheme. Which of the statements given above is or are correct? Keep in mind, we have to look for the correct statement. The first statement is correct because it is the objective of the FAME India scheme as announced by the government while notifying the scheme for phase 2. The second statement is also correct as we have seen that around 10 lakh two-wheeler vehicles are to be supported by the government. That amounts to around 64% of the total number of vehicles to be supported in the phase 2. The third statement is wrong as it is Ministry of Heavy Industries and Public Enterprises that is the nodal ministry and the Department of Heavy Industry is the nodal department of the planning, implementation and review of the scheme, not the Ministry of New and Renewable Energy. So the correct answer to this question is option C, 1 and 2 only. Next question is, consider the following statements. First statement, Maldhari tribes are a pastoral community living in Banni grassland and Gir region of Gujarat. Second statement, they are known for their unique drought resistant buffalo and Kankrech cows. Which of the above statements is or are correct? Here the first statement is correct as they live in Banni grasslands in Kutch district of Gujarat and also in Gir region of Gujarat. The second statement is also correct as Maldharis are known to rearing the drought resistant varieties such as Banni buffaloes and Kankrech cows. As the question has asked to choose the correct answer to this question is option C, both 1 and 2. Next question is, consider the following statements with reference to the no confidence motion. First statement, the motion can be moved in both Rajya Sabha and Lok Sabha. Second statement, the fate of the motion is decided by the speaker. Which of the above statements is or are correct? Here, the first statement is wrong because no confidence motion can be moved only in Lok Sabha and not in Rajya Sabha with respect to the parliament. The second statement is correct as the fate of the motion is decided by the speaker. So the correct answer to this question is option B, 2 only. Next question is, Basel Convention of 1989 deals with option A, persistent organic pollutants, option B, prior informed consent procedure for certain hazardous chemical products and pesticides in international trade, option C, control of transboundary movements of hazardous waste and their disposal. Option D, supervisory standards for banks. We have seen that the Basel Convention of 1989 deals with control of transboundary movements of hazardous waste and their disposal. So, option C is the correct answer. Also know that Stockholm Convention deals with the persistent organic pollutants and Rotterdam Convention deals with prior informed consent procedure for certain hazardous chemical products and pesticides in international trade. All these three conventions are collectively called as BRS convention. And also know that the supervisory standards for banks is nothing but the Basel norms. It is not Basel convention. Now let us see one mains question based on GS paper 2. With Comcasa, India has concluded 3 of the 4 foundational agreements with US. Discuss the implications of the Comcasa agreement on India. For answering this question, first mention about Comcasa. About how it facilitates the interoperability between militaries and sale of high-end technologies, etc. Then also mention that the data acquired through such systems cannot be disclosed or transferred to any person or entity without India's consent. Then also mention the concerns associated with this agreement as discussed in our analysis. Don't forget to like, comment and share. And don't forget to subscribe to our Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates on UPSC preparation.